A very, very good afternoon to all of you. McGraw-Hill welcomes you all to the Stay Tuned webinar series. Hope you're all doing safe and sound. Our topic for today is Role of Marketing in Times of Pandemic, presented to us by Dr. Rajan Saxena, the ex-vice chancellor of NMIMS University. Let's hear his thoughts on how this is the perfect opportunity to show you that you are there to provide them with the information, interaction, positive thoughts, and relevant sources. Let's hear it from Dr. Rajan Saxena on marketing, please. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Prakriti, for introducing me. Good afternoon to all of you. It's a pleasure to see many of you in this class this afternoon. Well, the topic has already been introduced. Many of you have known me through my book, and what I'm going to be doing today is really talking to you about the disruptions that have really taken place, and especially this black swan event that has occurred. And therefore, from that kind of a point of view, what exactly does it mean from the perspective of marketing? What's happening in our consumer's market itself? What is happening to the consumer? And therefore, what are the kind of strategies that the companies need to be adopting? What is it that the companies are doing? And what are the lessons that we can learn from them? Well, we are living today, and can we go to the next slide? We are living today in a world which has already been disrupted. It's a fact that the last two decades have been the decades of disruption. And essentially, much of these disruptions that we have seen are caused by technology. Now, what is more important about this technology is, and I'm going to be talking just slightly in a minute more about it, that this technology and all the other four forces, there is a kind of an interplay between these, among these five forces. For example, today, the whole lot of a geopolitical kind of an environment that we see and the geopolitical developments, much of which is really caused by a whole lot of an information that gets disseminated across the world. One of the most important kind of a geopolitical development that most recently relates to with regard to the disruption is this whole lot of a doubt over China, the role of China in COVID, and the US-China tiff as a result of that. It doesn't stop there only, but what really happens is that the USA and New Zealand and many other countries today have issues with WHO or with China itself, and possibly there's a whole lot of a movement which is now today developing, which is in terms of the boycotting the Chinese products or the products made in China. Clearly, we find that this is some part that we have got to be tackling with, and we're going to be living with it. And I'm going to talk about it, how this whole perspective today is leading towards what is called as ethnocentrism, which is a contrarian force to the globalization that we have talked about. We have talked about the interdependence of the markets. We have talked about the kind of a global consumer, but now we are seeing more and more people coming in, and the focus is more towards the local products and local solutions itself. There's another element, which is the demographic shifts that we have, that we are all aware of. And if we look at the demographic, or if we were to look at the most important, now let me just spend some little time, as I was saying, on the technology part. Well, obviously, technology today is there, and as I've always said, technology is really the human innovation in action. Look at it, what technology has done. Despite the fact that the world may say anything, and despite the fact that we talk about, let us say, the doubts that exist between one nation and another on the different kind of issues that are there, economic, political, or social, the fact is the world today is interdependent. And as a consequence of this, there is no single market which can today become a completely independent of the rest of the world. Even if we were to decide today to boycott any of the Chinese products, I wonder if, let us say, any one of us would be able to buy an Apple product, or for that matter, an IBM product, or any of the laptops, for example. Because if you were to look at it, the components that are there, a lot of these components that are made in China. Almost about 90% of the components are made in China. And they're shipped across the world. Even in the US, they're shipped. And in different markets, the Apple products get assembled, or for that matter, Lenovo gets assembled, or any other brand of the computer gets assembled. So there is an interdependent world that we talk about. We also realize that the internet has created this kind of an interdependence, especially the mobile internet that we talk about. Technology has had a disruptive effect across the industry, across different sectors, across different businesses itself. The social sector, for example, does not remain untouched by that. Education today isn't untouched by this. Our own classrooms are getting disrupted. Our own academic processes are getting disrupted. Our let us say, the delivery processes are getting disrupted. We do realize, you know, what had happened in the business of retail, for example, Amazon. It's a similar kind of a development which is now coming up when we talk about, say, the online learning platforms, like, for example, the Coursera itself, which are now today creating this kind of a disruption in the entire learning environment itself and the learning culture. Very important is technology today is pervasive. It's a leveler. Almost everybody can use it at any time, anywhere. So anyone can use it anytime, anywhere. Now that makes the kind of the effect of technology far more significant and therefore disruptive in nature itself. Technology is certainly very, very, very versatile. Many of the devices today can be used for multiple kind of, reasons itself, for multiple use situations. We can use the same kind of a device. A smartphone is not just merely a communication tool, but it is also an office on the go. Technology has certainly empowered the customer and has created what we call it as the skills obsolescence in the workplace. The demographic shifts is the next big variable in the last two decades. Look at the kind of effect that has happened of moving people from one market to another, from one region to another, from rural to urban, or from north to the south, from east to the west, or from the north to the west, or for that matter, let us say, from the south to the west. So what has really happened is that the composition of the local population today has changed dramatically. It is far more cosmopolitan. It is far more, a mixed population from the perspective of religion, language, or the value systems. Even for that matter, let us say, the habitats. Mumbai, for example, today has had a very large incident, a very, very significant incident of the coronavirus. The number of cases have been increasing almost every day and have been a cause of concern, not just in Mumbai, but even in Delhi. Now, if you were to look at these two cities itself and look at what has happened to the structure, to the composition of these two great cities, and you look at what are the habitats there, you realize why, or you get an answer for what is the reason why this kind of a pandemic is really increasing, or the incidence of infection is really increasing significantly. Now, clearly, what we realize is, take an example like the slums, or let's say the chawls in Mumbai, which have grown over a period of time. So clearly this means that this whole incidence of infection cannot really be controlled so easily. The age composition itself of Indian population the young population itself, that we talk about the young market, the regional imbalances that have existed. Now today, as I said, the Northeast is today one market, but then the Western region is another kind of a very big market. But what is happening that the regional markets are not all regional markets are not necessarily as equipped as the others are. So there's an issue of regional balance existing. There's also about the gender, how the whole gender today is there, the gender imbalances or the gender balance, the diversity. And the most important part, which I will again come back to it, is the increasing purchasing power that has happened in some markets. Now that all this has impacted the labor market and also the consumption behavior itself in the different markets itself. The socioeconomic factors, well, it's a fact that today we have seen a whole lot of a shift in the socioeconomic factors. Like, for example, the emergence of the single family, the single parent, or the power of the social endorsement. The fact that we are talking about single families has also meant that we have people who do not have a support system at the time of the pandemic. And at this point of time, the sources of information or how to get the information now becomes important. Now, all the sources of information now become significant. And that's where the social media now comes up in a very big way to create such kind of a social cohesion. Today, we are talking about social distancing. Now, that can have a bearing on the social structure. That's going to have a bearing on the psychological part of the consumer, the psychological aspects. The social effects of that are really going to be visible in the times to be coming. The value systems are going to be are changing. Aspiration is a very key value in Indian society. Now, today, for that matter, because of the income losses that are going to be happening as a result of the pandemic, and because of the closure of the companies today, because the economy today is not going to be doing well, the world is staring at a global recession itself, we realize that the middle class dream of improving their standards of living today stands question. They're today concerned about it. And therefore, the whole aspiration that we talk about, the big kind of a challenge for a middle class family is, how do I balance my budget with the aspiration to improve my standards of living? Similarly, the communication today have changed dramatically. There has been a social media which has become very, very important. And lastly, we talked about the income shifts itself. The third, and which is what we were talking about it, the more important thing is that today, the natural catastrophes like tsunami, or for that matter now, the coronavirus, the COVID-19, or the man-made catastrophes, like, for example, the extensive use of plastic, the complete disregard to Mother Earth, has created what is called as a global warming. And these kinds of catastrophes are today creating a whole lot of a change in the market itself. The whole lot of a change is really happening around. Consider, for example, you know, this whole part of what we say is in terms of the culture change, is in terms of looking at it from the perspective of the cultural changes or what is going to be happening around on the culture itself. You know, Taleb, who talked about the Black Swan event after the 2008 9/11, he said that, well, many of these catastrophes have never been known. Nobody has been able to anticipate. Yet the fact is that they have had an effect of changing the way we have looked at the world, of how the world has behaved thereafter. The world has changed. Similarly, after this COVID-19 is going to mean that the world is going to be changing. And what is this kind of a change? Look at it. A very typical kind of a human response in such a kind of a catastrophe is that it tends to shift towards what we call it as a reverse production, reverse prediction. And what is that reverse prediction? It says that, well, it could it not have been anticipated? Could it not have been better planned? Could we not have been better prepared? Why is it, for example, we just talked about it, or we heard the Prime Minister declare the lockdown one, and gave us just 3 hours and 4 hours? That caused a huge lot of loss, or a huge lot of kind of disruption in the economy itself. We've had people who really moved away from all over the world, all over the country, back to their own home itself. So what is really happening? That this part of it, you know, it absolutely changes the entire culture. It creates suspicion among groups of people. It creates suspicion among nations. It also creates a fear. There's a fear psychosis today, for example. And the fear is about, am I going to get it? If that is what is going to be happening, will I really survive? Will I be there after this coronavirus? So this whole fear, anxiety, it becomes a reality. And almost everybody starts rationalizing by reflecting whether these events could have been better predicted and probably avoided. COVID-19 has had a bearing, has had a significant kind of an impact across the world itself. We have seen, for example, the one of the kind of a response across the world had been to lockdown. Put the people in their home, ask people to stay back at home, work from home, study at home, learn at home, do whatever you want to do, but do it at home. The economy was in shatters. Nobody really bothered about the economy. Nobody bothered about the markets. Nobody looked at what is going to be happening to the retail. Nobody looked at what is going to be happening on the investments. And clearly, the lockdown became a way forward. And clearly, and obviously, we do realize that the impact was far deeper now today. Today, as I said, there's a fear of global recession. There's an anxiety in the minds of the individuals. There's an anxiety among all of you, for example, about your job, about the future. There's a fear of unknown. And nobody knows. Therefore, there is an uncertainty. Nobody knows how long it is going to be. Nobody knows what is going to be the line of treatment. A struggling economy means businesses closing down, job losses. And job losses clearly mean that the incomes will collapse. And if incomes collapse, the middle class dilemma of balancing aspirations, income, and home budgets now becomes significantly important to the housewife itself. To the consumer, it is, believe me, one of the studies showed of the World Bank that the worst affected are the people who were coming out of their poverty levels. You know, it's a fact that Indian market was upwardly, or have been an upwardly mobile market. People have been coming out from their, let's say, the poverty levels. So the low income group were moving towards the middle income. The middle income were moving towards the high income, and then moving towards the rich and the super rich that we were talking about it. We've all seen how the pyramid was shifting towards becoming what is called as a rectangle, the income rectangle that we see, the population rectangle that we see, income rectangle that we see. This kind of a dilemma today, or this middle class families, which constitute the bulk of the market, which constitute the backbone of the Indian market, today they have a dilemma of balancing aspirations, income, and the home budget itself. Mobility is today impacted. And obviously, it means what? That I'm worried about now what's going to be there tomorrow, whether I'm going to be having a job or not. But my life is safe. So a whole lot of our migrant population that happened, people started returning home. And clearly we find that one of the kind of an effect has also been that there's been a cultural changes that have happened. For example, if you look at the consumer behavior today, which I'm going to be coming back again on it, it is to many a time it has become irrational. The emotional stress that is today is there, emotional stress, is leading towards what is called an irrational behavior. One kind of an effect of this irrational behavior is a stockpiling. Stockpiling of essentials, stockpiling of medical supplies, stockpiling of everything that I think is important for me in my day-to-day home matters itself. A stockpiling is bad not only from a from the producer's point of view, but also from the consumer's point of view. It's an indication of the emotional stress that is existing. The consumer rights, for example, we have recently seen in America, for example, over George Floyd's death itself in America, how the consumers just simply, you know, went on to create what we call it as a kind of a crisis in the market itself or in the cities there itself, you know, the consumer riots, the migrant population that we just said. You know, there is also a psychological effect of all this which is happening. The depression, for example, violence in homes, for example, insomnia, for example, and the drinking, the alcohol itself. So we got to look at it, and as a marketeer, we need to be aware of some of these things. There are now new normals which are now emerging. Physical distancing. I have to today stand outside my retail store in a queue at a 3 feet distance before I can really talk to the retail store owners for my supplies. When I go out of my home, I have to wear the mask. When I come home, I have to wash my hands. I today work from home. And clearly now today, the focus is on essential, looking at the core and not really the non-core products itself. So I'm willing to compromise on my non-essential products consumption, but to only focus on and put my money only for the core product itself. So next, if we move towards, is to look at it now from the perspective of what is now the corporate response. The most important kind of a corporate response is really the CSR, to really be a responsible citizen. I think this is going to be a very, very significant. The fact is that if the companies are seen as responsive today, as a responsible citizen who take care of their employees, who take care of the marginal and the poor people, who take care of their environment, these companies will enjoy a significant kind of an equity in the market. And not only the companies, but even their brands will enjoy a significant kind of an equity. Tata's, for example, opened up their Taj Lands End property in Bandra for the healthcare professionals. Vodafone in UK, for example, you know, came up, told their postpaid customers that they have an unlimited, that they can download unlimited data. They can access unlimited data. They have an access to that without any charges itself. Even for those who were paying on a monthly basis, even there they said, you can now have a free access to the data itself. So the corporate social responsibility becomes important over here. We go to the next one. So therefore, from this kind of a point of view, is, and this is where we are talking about it, that we got to look at it from the perspective of now, you know, the new dimension now, which is now emerging of marketing, which is more humane and less selfish. The goal goes beyond the profits. It goes beyond the immediate short-term profits and the sales. It looks at it from the perspective of the societal good itself. It looks at the social good. It looks at the community involvement. It looks at engaging the customer through reliable, honest, and complete information itself. There we have heard, for example, some of the practices of, or some of the cases of the exploitative practices in the healthcare sector or the PPEs. So what is then the new kind of a societal marketing that we are talking about it? The societal marketing that we talk about is, really speaking, talks about understanding, of course, the target market's needs, wants, and interests. But what is far more significant is to deliver on them in a manner that enhances customers and society's well-being. Please keep both of them in mind. It is both the customer and the society's well-being that becomes important. It calls upon the marketer to be ethical. So the marketing ethics now become important. It calls upon the companies to be socially responsible and balance the objectives of profits, customer satisfaction, and public interest itself. It requires companies. There's a role for internal marketing, and the transparency and the care in marketing communication is really required. Let me turn to one of the very, very interesting ad of a brand that we have all admired, we have all known about, the Coca-Cola. How does Coca-Cola really take it forward? So Media One, let's play. Thank you. This is, I just saw a comment over here that Coca-Cola is not a good not good for health. So I'm not going to be getting into that. We are not talking about that. But it's a brand which is globally today in one of the top 150 brands world over. We are all aware about it. But let's not get into that. What is far more significant in this ad is to look at how the brand with which we have grown, how it really communicates to the consumer, how it creates a hope, how it really educates the market also, and simultaneously says that it is that human spirit which will always succeed over there. How it talks about the caring part of it. And I think it is this part that we have got to be communicating it every time. So the communication which we are talking about, the transparency and the care in marketing communication that we are referring to, I think it is this part that we have got to be always considering it. And more marketing communications are really going to be using it extensively, some of these kinds of communication tools itself and the approaches itself. So what is now the new marketing role in these times? Clearly, keeping the customer and employees safe all time. That's the first thing. Please bear this in mind that the brand has to also communicate to the employees today. They have to keep their employees safe and let their employees know that we care for them, just as we care for the customers. And many a time that you would have seen, when you would have reached out to a bank on the phone, they would have told you that we are sorry, we are not there right now because we don't want to expose our own employees to the risks that are there. And we don't want to expose you to the risks that are there. So whatever that you want to do with the bank, do it through the digital kind of a mechanism itself. We'll talk about it just in a minute itself, just in a few seconds itself. The other one is very clearly what we talk about, maintaining the stocks in the market. The brands have got to be available in the market. And in case they're not able to, you know, maintain those stocks in the market, the customer must be informed when the replenishment is going to be happening or when the delivery is going to be happening. Customer retention now takes priority over customer acquisition because the importance is to deliver to your existing customers and not really speaking acquisition of the customers. The brand has to reward the loyalty by giving existing customers order a priority. For example, you know, many of the e-delivery portals, they said that we are closed. For example, DMart refused to take any new customer because they said we are already full. We are only serving our existing customers. And the same thing was happening with with the Big Basket, or with many other kind of e-deliveries itself. So acquiring the new customer now would be only when the firm is able to deliver, only when the firm has the capacity. So retaining the customer now becomes important and creating the cash flow from there is important. Let's look at this next ad, one of the kind of a brand with which we are all aware of. This is the Domino's ad, which recently came in the Times of India. What really struck me was that it talked about zero contact takeaway. Until now, we had heard of zero contact delivery. That is a contactless delivery. But here we are saying zero contact takeaway. And then it tells you what does it mean. It says that, well, you need to download an app. Now, what does the app say? App said that, well, you got to select the takeaway or dine-in kind of an option from the app homepage. It says, select your city and the nearest restaurant. Click on proceed and add your favorite item to the cart. And then it says, select your preferred time to pick up the delivery. And it says, pay by using any of the digital modes. And then they also say that they are going to start baking your pizza only 15 minutes before so that we get the pizza which is hot. It's all packed with your order number there, and we just have to take it forward itself. So the employee safety now becomes important. The role of marketing, the customer in customer value maximization, you know, it's an important part even today. Customers are wanting to look at it from the perspective of how can I maximize my value. With income decline, the pressure on prices is going to continue to be there. More and more customers will compromise on high-priced product with lower-priced products. They're likely to go towards the lower-priced substitutes itself. And customers are likely to defer consumption, as I said, of the non-essential products. They're likely to trade down the purchases, which I just mentioned. So the core or essential now become important. And the focus will be on, are you able to solve my problem 24/7? So therefore, the 24/7 online support now becomes most significant in our strategies itself. Let's go to one of the very interesting study. And this is a study very recently done by BCG. Now, BCG did a study, a global study. And what is it that is going to be winning across the various markets itself? And when we look at this kind of a chart, what we realize is that and they looked at the consumers, and they looked at it from the perspective of how many of them are going to be spending more than 20% on the various product categories, and the product categories where they're going to be spending less than 20%. Now, if you look at the kind of winners, the green itself, the winner is in-home entertainment in all categories. The second is the essential, the food products. That are the winners, where the consumers across markets, across countries, across cultures are saying that we are going to be spending more than 20% itself. Savings, except for Japan, in all other countries, it has now become important. Education has become important in UK, Italy, Australia, and France. Who are the losers? Look at the right-hand side, the red dots. And you clearly have the non-essential. For example, the holidays, the luxury homes, the eating outside, and some of those areas that are there. We go to the next part. If you look at, let us say, in India, what is really happening? Clearly, we find that the digital media, the consumption of the digital media has gone up in this COVID times, in this lockdown period. But the online games, for example, by almost 1.25 times what they were really before the lockdown period. But what is more important is the digital purchases, apart from the digital media. It is the digital purchases. And if you look at the digital purchases, the fresh food, for example, 1.7 times it has gone up. Staple food, 1.4 times it has gone up. And the personal care products have gone up by 1.3 times. And the adoption of the digital payments has simply gone up significantly. So what we see is that the consumers in India have really adopted digital activities and are far more willing to continue the same in the future itself. Look at the digital payments. Now, this is the same story over here. The digital payment is the same story. We find that that a preference for non-cash payments is today emerging in India and will continue to be in the future itself. Whether this is, and it isn't just merely in the metro cities, but it is across India that we are talking about it. So now, despite all that, the fact that I see some shortages in my e-deliveries, the fact that I am not able to get what I am wanting, my essential products itself, it creates what I call it, which I just referred to earlier, the irrational behavior, the stockpiling kind of a behavior. And therefore, the mismatch between the demand and the supply. The demand occurs, the consumer goes to the retail store, or goes to the, whether this is a physical or an e-retail store, not finding him there, the consumer becomes more and more anxious. He becomes, you know, the emotional crisis now starts building up. And now the stockpiling behavior comes in. Look at it now from the perspectives of this entire sort of a behavior of the consumer, this irrational behavior that we see, irrespective of whether the supply is through a e-channel or through a physical channel itself, that there's a panic in the market that occurs, causing consumer riots, which I just mentioned. And the imbalance leads to customer impatience. As a brand, as a company, they have got to, one of the kind of an implication in today's marketing is to reduce such kind of a impatience or to help consumers win over their impatience itself. We go to the next one. So what is then the marketeer's role? It is to reassure customers on the replenishment. Many a time, even the customer does not know, or even the company is not able to know when exactly the replenishment is going to be taking place. So then in that case, the range now becomes important. Amazon did it the best to communicate the possible range of days. That is what I'm saying. Work with the government to remove supply blockades. Today, government is a very important player in the market, in market making, in ensuring that the markets are stable. So therefore, the brands need to work with the government and keep communicating on the supplies. Advise the customers to use digital route rather than visiting the retail store or the branch outlets itself. Let's see two brands with many of you are very familiar with. One is Louis Philippe. Many of you would have seen it as one of the shirt makers or the garment makers itself. And the other one is the Dettol, the brand with which we are all familiar. How they have really used, or how they are looking at their role, and in terms of educating the customer, what is it that they should be doing? So let's play media 2 and 3.
अरे अब कौन जाएगा इतनी दूर?
हॉस्पिटल तो और भी दूर है अंकल, वहाँ ना जाना पड़ जाए।
कोई बहाने नहीं, अब चलेंगे, लेजी नहीं होंगे हो। इन्फेक्शन मिटाना है, सबको बताना है, डेटॉल डेटॉल हो। खाने से पहले सदा हाथ धोना, कभी भी ना भूलेंगे हो।
अच्छा बताओ, अब यहाँ कैसे होगा तुम्हारा डेटॉल डेटॉल हो?
घर हो या बाहर हो, पानी हो या ना हो, डेटॉल डेटॉल हो।
अरे कौन सा कीचड़ लगा, साफ ही तो है।
नहीं नहीं नहीं, सही से हाथों को धो, ना पहले बीमारी जो आदत हमारी, डेटॉल डेटॉल हो।
साबुन से सच्चा है, साबुन से अच्छा है,
डेटॉल डेटॉल हो।
डेटॉल लिक्विड हैंड वॉश और सैनिटाइजर दे 100 बीमारी फैलाने वाले जर्म से सुरक्षा,
तभी तो मामा ने सिर्फ डेटॉल का धुला।
So clearly, what we find is that the responsible brand communication now is on educating the customer. And what is it that the brand needs to communicate? Safe habits. And not just many ones, but the same message has got to be repeated. For example, the Dettol ad was made much earlier than the lockdown. But it still communicates the same message of how important it is to wash the hands safe and how it can really be a good practice itself. So one has to communicate regularly, frequently, with greater intensity. The brands have got to be doing it. And certainly the brands have got to be, the whole communication has got to be far more transparent. From an employee point of view and from the customer point of view, the most important thing is whatever the you are saying, in the whatever the brand is saying in the market, whatever the company is saying in the market, it must really implement it back in their own organization itself. So walk the talk. If you are saying we deliver on time, you better do it. And what is important is become a part of the community or of the state action to fight COVID itself. Social media perhaps is the best way of really reaching out, the most significant medium today. They're all aware of the fact. For example, we find that in January 2020, the average time that an individual was, you know, on the social media, it was 3.13 hours. But in the week of March 28 and April 3, the very first week of lockdown, it jumped to 4.39 hours. And in April 2020, the total number of global social media users went up to 3.3 billion people. So now in such a kind of a time period, what is important is to understand that the role of social media is so significant. And let me just go back slightly to understand that why it is so. Because the social media today has three significant roles: information, communication, and entertainment. Now I go to the Google, or I go to, let us say, or to my WhatsApp to really know what is happening around. I go on my Facebook to really know what is happening around. I also communicate. And I also use today the digital platforms. For example, the Netflix. I use Netflix. I use Amazon Prime. And therefore, you know, I learn how to use how to entertain myself at my home itself. Let's take a look at another kind of a study of done by the WebEx. How there has been an increase in online and digital activities in the country. Watching more shows and films, for example, at home, 57%. That is where, you know, the consumers are doing it. That's a 57% increase there. And similarly, the other part of it, like, for example, listening to more podcasts, for example, it's only 14%. It's a global study also, which includes India there. Spending more time in playing computer or video games, 35% of the world is there. Or, you know, communicating to the people itself, you know, for communication purposes, you find 47% kind of consumers are there. So you find that there has been an increase in online and digital activities itself. We go to the next one, which is, therefore, as I said, social media is required and we need to be using social media extensively because it is a better targeting. Needs for information, communication and entertainment is satisfied. It is today one of the most cost-effective media, and the communication effectiveness can today be assessed in a much better manner. All analytics can be done on this social media. Whether this is predictive analytics, it is the visual analytics, we can do that on this and create a kind of a forecast of the behavior, the consumer behavior itself. And it is extremely important that in such kind of a time period, we should be using it. The brand need to revisit their prices and their payment terms. As I said, the goal is to remain liquid. This is a short-term part of it. Long-term survivability, long-term sustainability is important. But today, what is important is survival. So therefore, important thing is reduce the prices to offload the inventory. The real estate, for example, in Mumbai or elsewhere in the world, in the country, is suffering, particularly in Mumbai, because of the high prices. No consumer today can really buy a flat in Mumbai because I'm not too very sure of what is going to be happening around tomorrow. So therefore, what is important is to consider the marginal cost price model itself. You would have seen, for example, the Zoom, or for that matter, let's say, any of the video-based conferencing kind of the tools that are there, you know, they say that pay-per-use or subscription model. They give you they give you an opportunity to use it for free for some time. And then they say, if you want to use it for a longer time period, then you pay. Even the subscription prices have been discounted. For example, Coursera today has issued licenses to campuses, which is free of cost until July end itself. And they're looking at possibly extending it if the campuses are, if the students don't come back to the campuses, and if online learning is going to grow, then in that case they would be considering, or they may have to consider, a kind of extending that kind of a free offer itself. Clearly, the digital payment options and the brands also need to now create or use those various platforms itself. And customers should have the freedom to select the payment modes itself. So let's take a, therefore, what if I were to say in end, these are challenging times. They require innovation. They require as much innovation, not just merely in product design, but even in marketing processes. Even when we are using the digital technologies, it requires innovation. It requires going back to the basics in marketing. Customer, please keep this, the brand has to keep this in mind, that the customer will sail it through the tough times. It requires transparent governance of marketing processes and credible communication with the consumer. We need, the brand need to accept the fact that the digital marketing is here to stay. Thank you very much. Prakriti, I'm open for, and all the participants, I'm open for the questions.
Perfect, sir. I think people have enjoyed your speech very, very much. We have got great comments from the attendees. So we'll take a few quick questions.
Thank you.
Okay. So the first one is that there's going to be a paradigm shift, maybe, observably in the consumer behavior, especially the buying behavior of the consumers. So do you feel that this is going to be now a constant change in what people buy? And do we as marketers need to change how we perceive the situation and how we react to it?
Yes, I think so. There is a paradigm shift which is going to be happening around, and it is already occurring. As I said in my presentation, the most significant kind of a paradigm shift is that consumers are willing to compromise on their non-essential product purchases. The social products, for example, which I bought for improving, for enhancing my esteem. For example, a car model that I bought, or I would have bought, like a BMW or a high price kind of any car model. Today I said, no, I don't want that. So I would either defer buying a car, or if required, I may go in for the lower price kind of a product itself. Not only so, what I would also say is this is an evolving situation. So therefore, what is important is to keep the short term and the long term perspective. The long term perspective is to survive, is to create a sustainability. The short term perspective is to survive. And therefore, we cannot miss out on the innovations in the long run itself.
Right, sir. So I think what we understood is that we need really need to think in several time frames. Yes. Yeah. So I think that what we've understood is that we really need to think in several time frames, and we need to be ready for what's upcoming as well, not just the current scenario. So we have another question. We saw a lot of beautiful examples from you on how brands have been empathizing with customers. We just had, the audience just had this one question. So do you feel that this also is a way of overdoing the empathy? Do you feel that customers might react to it in a way that they are just sympathizing with us based on the COVID-19 pandemic? The ads which are, overly trying
Could
to
be.
Relate their branding to the pandemic. Okay.
Could be. If, let us say, the brand is dominant.
Yeah.
If the brand is more dominant than the message, if the content If the content is subservient to the brand, then the consumer may resist. But if the brand is played in a subtle kind of a format, then that kind of a resistance will not be there. All these three ads that I am talking about have had some wonderful kind of a response from the consumer market itself. The research has shown that all these three brands have really communicated, that the effectiveness of the communication has been fairly high.
Okay, so is there going to be a concept change in brand loyalty during COVID times?
I think that the change is not there. The concept of the brand loyalty still persists, it still exists, and will continue to exist. There is simply no denying about it. It will continue to exist. There is no doubt about it.
Right.
But what is significant, therefore, is to that the brand need to go back to the loyalty-based business model itself, which is what I discussed it in my marketing management book itself. Then what is that loyalty-based business model itself?
Okay.
In the loyalty-based business model, we are looking at it from the point of view of the brands creating multiple kind of practices, developing multiple tools that will enhance the connect with the brand itself, the consumers connect with the brand, and communicating with the consumer on a regular and more frequent kind of a manner, and in a manner which is credible and authentic. And every time that the consumer is buying, rewarding the consumer. So this whole and the rest of it, which comes up in the loyalty-based business model. Now, in today's time, when I'm stressed out, I'm looking at the brand, I'm looking at my brand helping me. Let me give you an example. One of the nationalized bank, for example, if a bank does not bother to communicate with its consumers in this time, the consumer is likely to shift soon after the pandemic. Because it says, look, every time if I want something, I do not know how to really get it. So I have to visit the branch. Now, I can't visit the branch. Even if I go visit the branch, I'm kept outside. There's nobody to help me around. I want to use a digital mechanism to reach out. The online banking is not activated. And the third that happens is, then in that case, the only way is to really go to an ATM. But when I go to the ATM, I can only withdraw the money. There's nothing else that I can really do. So the bank is seen as a non-responsive brand. And when the time comes, such a consumer is likely to shift business completely from such kind of a financial institution.
Right. That was very insightful, sir. So, we'll take one more. This is, yes, sir. So we'll take one more. This is a very, very insightful answer, sir. We'll take this one question, which says that, companies are battling these days with a challenge like containing costs. And, we have to as well think of increasing the customer engagement, which, of course, involves substantial costs. So how do you feel we should be balancing it out? Or if you have any tips on how we should be managing all these things?
See, as I said, the managing cost today is one of the very important kind of a I would say element in our marketing or in our corporate response itself. Now, it is there that one has to start looking at, can I look at disintermediating or creating a disintermediation in the market itself? Can I really get the consumers to come more and more directly to me and place the order on me, and I'm able to deliver to them directly? The second big kind of a way by which it could be to aggregate the orders of the consumer and let the consumer then disaggregate it in their own home itself, rather than, somebody else in the retail store doing it across. So you do that kind of an aggregation. The third possible way is to look at it from the point of view of direct reach. As I said, one is the delivery, the other is communication. The print today is a very expensive media to really communicate. So therefore, how do I really use the social media? Amazon, for example, extensively, you know, sort of communicates with its consumers through the through its own apps, through the Google, through emails, through SMS, through, you know, multiple other kind of a ways by which it really happens. So all the tools that are available, you know, including the voice blast that one can use on the telephone, these are the ways by which they can really make a big difference to the communication. And therefore, the communication budgets can therefore get managed. So communication and distribution budgets can really be taken care of from that kind of a point of view. But at the same time, the new product development must not be lost sight of, because once the vaccine gets developed, one big opportunity, for example, is going to be in vaccine marketing, for example, in pharmaceutical companies itself. Not only so, but there would be a whole lot of other product opportunities that are going to be coming in as a consequence of this. PPE, for example, today, the development, so one of the textile companies, for example, in Ahmedabad or in some of the other companies, cities, you know, they were making, let us say, the denim, for example, they were producing denim, and they moved very quickly towards making of the PPEs and the gear that, you know, the healthcare professionals really wear. Mahindra, for example, started using their facility, the vehicle manufacturing facilities, for making of ventilators, and thereby, you know, enabling the government initiative of creating a capacity which the government was able to use it to fight COVID itself. So it is, you know, that whole lot of an looking at what you can do with your existing capacity in this kind of a time period. What else can you really do it? That is important.
Of course, sir. I think I can very, very easily relate to you. I also came across a very similar example very recently, that maybe Hennigan started making hand sanitizers recently to help our you know, customers, which was a great thing to do as a brand.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So before we move on, before we move to your parting note, yes, just one last question. So what do you recommend is better in such times to communicate with the audience? Is it the written content, or, you know, you feel that videos are a better way to communicate with the customers in your experience?
All medium are important. All kind of a way, every way, whatever is the way that you are able to reach out, the brand is able to reach out, whether this is through the video, through an audio, through a text message, whatever that is there. But the most significant kind of a content has to be, I care for you. I care for the community. I care for the society. And I want you to be safe. That is important. And I want you to join me to say, happy days are going to be back again.
That's good. So happy days are going to be back again. So we'll listen to your parting notes. You have any final set of words for our audience?
Well, my parting note is, well, friends, many of you who are the faculty members, it's a time for you to redefine your marketing contents. Evolve your marketing contents, not from the perspective of only, let's say, the pandemic, but look at it from the perspective of that how should the brands respond to such kind of black swan events, which are likely to happen more frequently. Unfortunately, 100 years ago, when a similar kind of a black swan event happened in this world, right, in 1918, the flu itself, which killed millions of people itself, we didn't have any lessons to learn. There were no lessons. Here today, there are lessons which are emerging. I think as a teacher, we got to be keeping live to the kind of lessons that are today emerging. The brands are communicating those lessons. The government is communicating. The government communications are communicating. The television is also communicating. So from various sources, whatever is happening around, look at what are the lessons that we can draw, and if we can build a kind of a content around that, and then contribute towards giving a kind of let us say an article, or building up a class session, which can contribute towards development of a new marketing philosophy, which is going to be valid for the new world, because the world is going to change. And when the world is going to change, whatever we were teaching until yesterday, as I said, until yesterday we said, market is aspirational. So therefore, brands have got to create that kind of an aspirations to really improve their social status. So I really appeal to the esteem and towards the self-actualization. Today, what is important is to say, no. Let's go back to the basic itself. The core is important. So it is these aspects that we need to be considering it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an interactive session. Thanks to all our attendees who joined us today to make this session a great, great interactive session. Just a small announcement before we part ways. The session recording, the presentation from SIR certificates will be shared with you within the next 7 days on your registered email IDs. And in case we are unable to reach you, please give us a mail at support.india@mheducation.com. We love to hear from you. We are also going to be circulating a feedback form for all of you, so please let us know your thoughts. Also, we are also going to be live on 18th June at 3 p.m. to understand the future of education from another great speaker. So we'll wait for you to join us. If you've not registered, please register today. Stay home, stay safe. Thank you, everyone. It was a great, great session. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Prakriti, just one minute. Can I just let the audience know that my email ID is, if they want to get in touch with me, they can get in touch with me at the email ID, a simple kind of a mail ID, Dr. Rajan Saxena, @yahoo.com. You can communicate to me by that kind of a mail, and I'll be able to respond to you at the time that I'm able to do it ASAP. So it's been a pleasure having you all, and thank you very much for coming to this program.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for sharing the email ID as well. I think all of them will be in contact with you. Thank you.
Thank you.